All right, Parashat HaShavua, with a little different background. Parashat HaShavua, Parashat Mishpatim. What should we say about this parasha? There are a few questions that I want to present to you in this point through the questions that I want to, you know, bring out to you. As the beginning, it says in Parashat, in our parasha, it says Naaseh, and after that it says Naaseh v'nishma. Sounds a little unnecessary. Therefore, what is the difference between Naaseh and Naaseh v'nishma? What does it tell me, if at all, about internal processes, about pnimiyut sheli, inside to me, internally, spiritually? What is so special in this Naaseh v'nishma that became a focal point of Judaism, and many times that became like the milestone of, or the turning point of Judaism and Jews and their relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Why do we have to say all together, Ve'elu arei mishpatim, elu mishpatim? These are the laws. After all, Bnei Yisrael already received the, or accepted upon themselves the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. So what's the point of more? That's it, you gave him. What's the point of that? And at somewhere in the middle of the parasha, it says, "Im kesef talve et ami," if you going to borrow one of my people or my nation, kesef. Kesef really means money or sometimes silver. What does it have to do with money? Is this din only applied to money or silver or to any kind of a loan? What's so special about this thing? So, in order to try to understand that, you know, we need to look closely. First of all, a parasha is about 53 different mitzvot mentioned in this parasha. What you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do, how to do. And the people says Naaseh. Then Moshe reads to them from Sefer HaBrit, from the Torah. And Am Naaseh, the people say Naaseh v'nishma. Naaseh will do, and they will hear. We need to understand that there are different types of mitzvot interactions of that are divided into three different categories. There are mishpatim, edot, and chukim. Mishpatim are those mitzvot in which I could understand with my logic immediately what's the reason behind them, what's the purpose. It's very common sense. Edot are those mitzvot in which I don't understand quite quickly what's the reason behind. But after dwelling in, if you're going to sleep on me, after dwelling in and learning, if I say sleeping, turn the camera to him so we can see exactly who that is. You see it on national TV, international TV. Who is the sleeper? Should we call him the sleeper cell? His name, I don't want to say it because everybody will know who we're talking about. Right, so adult are those laws in which I would need further looking into. It's not so obvious what is the reason, what's the purpose of that. Turn off the phone, please. Put it away. And chukim are the mitzvot in which are beyond my ability to understand, even if I would dwell in them Hafoch ve'afoch po, over and over and over again. It is beyond my ability to understand what's the reason behind them. And the unique thing about those mitzvot, of those what we call the chukim, is that the kiyum of this mitzvot, fulfilling those mitzvot, or the ability to fulfill the mitzvot, will be dependent on my emunah, on my belief. And the ability to do that depends on the capacity of my belief. I have greater emunah, I will be able to execute them with greater, I would say, ease and with better performance. Achukim are those of, referred to as the Naaseh V'Nishma. When Am Yisrael says Naaseh V'Nishma, he was referring to the Chukim, and we'll see why. There is a great secret in that to our lives. It's a great secret to that. If our essence of life is to operate and to be be'asiya, in action, all the time, so therefore, first of all, asiya means to do. I need to do things, to create. Asiya, it's olam asiya, the world of doing. So therefore, first of all, I have to be be'asiya. I have to be involved in doing something. That's the na'aseh. First of all, I have to start doing. Just the opposite of what we say. We say talk the talk and walk the walk. That doesn't work like this. When it comes to mitzvot, it's walk the walk, then talk the talk. Just the other way around. You have to do it. And after I would learn, and I would try to understand, then there will be the part of Eshma. I would listen. First of all, I need to be in the action, in doing. And after the action and doing, there's going to be what we call in Hebrew, Vada'ut, the certainty that I'm certain, I know, the affirmation of my actions. In our world is different. The way we operate is different. Usually, it is, we say, I would let my knowledge, my intellect, affirm what I need to do, then I'm going to do it. Many times, Rabotai, we miss the great opportunities of our lives waiting for affirmations that never come. It just doesn't make sense to us to do a certain thing, and we wait for affirmation, a signal from God at best. More we want our logic to sit down according to our logic. Who said that our logic is logical to begin with? Who told you that? Why do you think that your logic is so logical? You want to weigh everything. That's why we, by the way, we're so, I think, obsessed with statistics. Well, if for the past four Super Bowls, every winning team had to play, and the opener had to play the Eagles. That's why they won, statistics. How many Super Bowls were so far? I don't know, 40-something? 46. 46. So 42 did not play the Eagles, they still won the Super Bowl. That has nothing to do with anything. But I want an affirmation that through my statistics, I am somewhat in control of the things, and therefore I could determine, and then I will act upon, I'll play the Vegas, I'll do it like this. I need an affirmation that this thing that I'm about to do is good. I'm going to go to pick up a career in my life based on my, I would examine, is this a good field to be in? Is this a bad field to be in? Is this a profitable field to be in? Is there a future in this this field for me to go in? And then I choose based on my data. But you neglected one little thing. It's quite possible that altogether you don't even like what you're going to pick. That's why nothing ever gets done. If you're going to wait for things to happen, you would achieve absolutely nothing in your life. And that's why it says, Elu ha-mishpatim. These are the mishpatim. To teach also Bnei Israel, that listen, Sheva mitzvot Bnei Noach, okay, there's no problem with them. Sheva mitzvot Bnei Noach is terrific. And they come though, Mechamat Derech Eretz, because of Derech Eretz, it's common sense, it's polite, and Higayon, common sense, it makes sense. It makes sense not to have an anarchy, to have judges, it makes sense to respect each other's commitment, and so on and so forth. Not to be cruel to animals, to not to eat ever minachai, and it makes sense. But derech kiyum ha'olam, the way the world is existing or established, that's the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. The world needs to operate through those mitzvot. But that's not the darga, the level of what is so-called Bnei Yisrael. The Madriga of Bnei Yisrael requires the person to operate from a completely different awareness. And that is to operate from Emunah. And to operate in the level of Bnei Yisrael, I need to bring not your intellect, I need to bring your Emunah, your belief, your ability to believe in it, in your actions. Not only the Sechel, not only the logical, not only the intellect. Am Israel is therefore required to do that, to bring everything up through doing what is so called chukim and edot. And you need to look, not only you need to look, okay, this is the law, I need to look further into the law. And then after you look further, you go yourself to another level in which you do the things that are, I know that it's beyond my ability, but I have an emunah, and we'll see why that is important to do. That Havana, Baruch Haba, Shechianu. He came right on time. A little late, but right on time. That Havana, that understanding that those mitzvot were given from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and we are his slaves. And not again because of that's a polite thing to do. By doing so, by understanding, that's the emunah, by understanding that every time I do a mitzvah, my love for HaKadosh Baruch Hu, my appreciation for him will increase. And together with that, my ability to attach myself to him. You know what the word, I have a new concept for the word mitzvah for you. With mitzvah, we always say mishon what?
Tzivui.
Command. And I'll tell you, I'll give you something else. In Aramit, okay, oh, forget. In Hebrew, how do you say a team? Like SEAL team? Team. You say tzevet. Tzevet, a group. Betzavta in Aramit is to do it together. Bechibur. Through doing the mitzvot, I'm becoming a team with God. I'm doing the mitzvot and I'm fulfilling something that remind me at the end, if I didn't say it, to say it, I'm fulfilling something very important. There is a pasuk that says, Hashamayim Shamayim le Hashem. Ve'aretz natan levnei adam. So we said one time a perush on that. But I'll introduce you, if I remember, and you have to remind me if I don't, what does exactly mean? And we'll see it. So therefore, when I'm doing a mitzvah, I'm becoming a team with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And by doing so, I'm becoming closer. Your teammates, if you're ever going to be worthy enough and lucky enough to operate in a team, especially, unfortunately, I don't know how to look at it, different ways to look at it. You don't, or probably would never experience what is so-called brothers in arms. The brotherhood of blood through being a team in a situation like a war. That's something that is going to be greater than the connection that you have with your own siblings and families. You can break it. That is something that is so great you'll be willing to give your life without hesitation for your friend. Similar, or along the same lines, should be your love and this companionship and this teamwork with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. If you have an experience, or what does it mean to be a part of a team to the point you're willing to give your life, you might have a little difficulties to do Avodat Hashem and connect it to Him on that level. Unless you are really a person that took deep down inside of Him. It's very, very difficult otherwise. So, by doing those mitzvot, I also understand that they would lead me to become an example for people. I'll show the people how it should be, to fix my ways with great excitement that I'm getting the option and the opportunity to serve God. And it says, the parasha says, the Torah says, Ela mishpatim asher tasim lifnehem, in which you're going to place in front of them. In front of them to do what? In front of them is lachkor, to investigate, lidrosh, to question. Not only the svara, it makes sense to do that, but rather to learn how to measure what would the Torah's point of view on that matter. And that's how you become, or you develop what is so-called Da'at Torah. As politically speaking, I have my opinion about this, I think it's cruel, I think, politically speaking, but maybe the Torah has a completely different view on that, so therefore my view is basically wrong. My logic would tell me one thing, but since the Torah tells me something completely different, that is wrong. A person that has a problem with that is a person that did not learn, investigated that prospect of Tasim Lifnehem appropriately. You want to know what I mean? I'll give you an example. In our parasha, it says, it's something that we were learning in Kiddushin, right? About the matter of the slave, and if he has a master, Im Adonav iten lo isha, if his master will give him a wife, Ve'yalda lo banim u'banot, and she gave birth for boys and girls. So what does it mean? Well, we'll just learn all the time. If a person is a slave, his master can give him a wife, and shifchak na'anit, and he can have children, and so on and so forth. Right? That's that, right? No problem. We understand. Logically, we understand. It's very humane. You don't want to leave a person without a wife, without a woman. It's a natural thing. A person needs a family. It is normal. It's humane. It's the right thing to do. Right? Wrong. I mean, it's right, but it's not only that. For example, the Zohar says the following. You ready for the Zohar? A little Kabbalah? Okay. The Zohar says that Adonav, his master, is referred to who? Refers to God. Listen carefully, all you bachelors. So the Zohar learns from here that the person, therefore, must pray for HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that it would send him is zivug matim, is appropriate and right match, because Adon is Hashem, that is appropriate and designated to him mishamayim, from above. Then he would be able to fulfill as Adonav iten lo isha, his master will give him a wife. You have to pray. And when you found this zivug matim, which is the one who was designated for you from Shamaim, then Yaldalo Banimu Banot, then she gave birth to boys and girls. But wait, that's another continuation for the Pasuk. Vaisha veyeladea tiele Adonea. And the wife and the children, and I have to say is thank you. Aisha veyeladea, the wife and the children will be le'adonai, will be to the master. The wife and the children will be to the master. When this happened, therefore the wife and the children are holy and they are special to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But the person that goes after his eyes and chooses his soul, his mate, not his soulmate, his wife, according to his desires and based on his desires, without a prayer, might receive a zivug, a mate, that is not really his. And then, not only that he did not fulfill his duty in the world, he might never going to be able to do so. Because he's never going to have what is so-called Ezer Kenegdo, somebody to help him to fulfill his duty in the world. He went after his Ta'ava, after his desire. His children would go off the path. His children are not to Hashem. When you choose the one that God had sent you, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu take care of the wife, HaKadosh Baruch Hu would take care of the children. Why? Because that's what it says according to the Zohar. Aisha ve'yeladea, yule Adonav, Hashem is going to take care of them. Do you want a policy, an insurance policy for your children that will be on the good derech? You want an insurance policy for yourself? Choose the one that God gives you. Don't choose the one that goes after your yetzer, after your desire. Don't measure things according to that. And you will see how we're going to come up to this. I'll try to connect all the points together. Be'ezrat Hashem. Don't choose like that, because you're going to choose wrong. It says, and why is it wrong? We always joke about it, right? Matzah isha, matzah tov. Lo matzah od yoter tov, right? If I found a woman, found good. No. Let's be serious for a second. Matzah isha, matzah tov. He found good. Remember what we said yesterday. Good is positive. Bad is negative. Negative will kill you, destroy you. Good will build you. So matzah isha, matzah tov. In Masechet Brachot, he says, le'et metzo refers to the wife. Le'et metzo, according to Tehillim, that's based on the Pasuk in Tehillim. In Tehillim, in Psalms, it says, al ken, therefore, itpalel kol chassid, every pious person, every righteous man, would pray to you, when? For what? Le'et metzo, for a wife. Now, if you would take this literally speaking, based on logic, you would never come up with that. That is what is expected from us. Don't just take things on the surface. Do it because you have to do it, because that's the family you were born to. That's the social structure in which you were dropped into. No, do it because you want to investigate. Check, because you want to connect with it on a much higher level. On a much higher level. Which brings us to this issue of Im Kesef Talve Et Ami. I'm going to show you a little bit how it's connecting. Im Kesef Talve Et Ami Et Ani Imach. If money you would, let's translate it, if it would be money that you would borrow to my people, et ha'ani imach, to the poor person with you, lo tiyeh lo kenoshe. Don't be like a tax collector on him. How do you call these guys who are debt collector, you know, those nudnikim, they call you on the telephone.
Collection.
Huh? Collection agency, yes. Al tiyeh kazeh. Lo tasimun alav neshech. Don't oppress him. That's in our parasha. Now, kesef is always what? Dinero. Or silver. Kesef. But there's other words, other ways to look at it. Kesef, lishon kisufin. Lichsof to something. Nichsefa vegam kalta nafshi. Is to yearn. To look. To ask for. To look for. To yearn. That is, the main point in which a person should strive to is what is so called nichsefa vegam kalta nafshi, to be kosef, to yearn to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The light, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives us the light. We don't have to worry about the light. We have to worry about something else. We have to worry about the vessel in which the light will go in. And the kli, the vessel, the meaning of it, is kisufin. That's why it says, ismach lev, mevakshei Hashem. The heart of those who seek to Hashem, who seek Hashem, will rejoice. Remember what we said yesterday. Look how important simcha is. You cannot seek God, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if you are depressed. Ismach lev mevakshei Hashem. That if a person finds within himself a desire to look for Hashem, to cry to Him, to connect to Him, just for that, a person should be happy. If you have no desire, lo echpatli, Hashem, lo Hashem, I don't care, you know. That you have to be very worried. The fact that you want to please HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You wanna make Him happy. You wanna see. You wanna do what we say in Tefillat Shmona Esrei. V'techezena einenu v'shuvcha l'tzion berachamim. We're waiting for you. That's what certain parts of Judaism, 200 and something years ago, was the first thing that they want to take out. I don't want to be chozer l'tzion. The Reform movement in Germany took it out. When they took it out, they took God out too. At that point, for those people, Judaism was not anymore a religion or way of life. It became an intellectual thing. Im kesef, talve et ami, if a person find within himself kisufin, yearning, desire to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I'm thirsty to Him, therefore He needs to know that this was not given to Him bederech hateva, because it's not natural. Usually, a person desires what? Materialistic things. I want a car, I desire a better home, a vacation in whatever I'm vacationing, but not to Hashem. A person needs to know that desire to Hashem was given to him on a loan from God. Lo tiyeh li kenoshe, don't be like a collector agency. Don't think that this is understood or you can take it for granted. And they're always going to demand this. Yeah, Kadosh Baruch Hu, tell me, give me. Your job. You want me to desire to you? No problem. You make me. Don't think. You have to work on it. And this work comes, first of all, through appreciation. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave you this from the great love to you. How do you know, for example, that somebody loves you, really loves you? Whether it's your child, whether it's your wife, or whether it's your friends. When you see them every day, or you don't see them for a week or a month, and you somehow got on the phone and says, "Man, where are you? I missed you." Then you know that. You might understand now why HaKadosh Baruch Hu went away from us for a little while. So we could develop this kisufin, this desire to come close to us. It's also, there is a point of good into that separation between us and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Now we miss him. We understand how important he is in our lives. And therefore we need to do and prepare our lives, our homes and our souls to accept HaKadosh Baruch Hu for that moment, v'techezena ineinu. For that moment, you have to clean yourself up. It's important to you. Like a woman that the husband went away and she doesn't know when he's coming back. She's going to make sure that the house is clean every day. Maybe the husband will come. He doesn't want to see a mess. He wants to, she prepares it, even if it's years down the road. That's called kisufin. And you need to work. You need to work on that. You need to work on that. You need to start looking at what is it that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is doing for you. Why did he give me the mitzvot? Why do I have this tzavta, this mitzvah? The mitzvah is not a commandment. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is not a tyrant, Chas v'Shalom, that tells us things because he has nothing else to do. So he doesn't like us so much. He gave us 613 mitzvot. The other people they like, he gave him only 7. This is just the other way around. In our world, the one do you give more work is the one you don't like. The one you give little work is the one you like, right? I'll tell you that it's wrong. Because the one who does more work than others is the one that becomes more important. You most likely get rid of him, if you are thinking straight, the last. Because he who doesn't do any work, one day you're going to say, "I don't really need him. Please, we are cutting down." So HaKadosh Baruch Hu loves us. And he gives us. He wants us to be partners with him in that. And therefore, the question is, could be asked, whether those kisufim, desires, that a person has, that he himself yearns to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, is it a selfish thing, or it's something that could benefit the world around him? It's a good question. Am I working on myself? It's all about me, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu, or how do I do it? It's going to work on the whole thing. So a person needs to understand that the whole entire world, this is according to Baal HaSulam, that the whole entire world is formed and it is one unit, miksha achat, one solid piece, which you cannot separate. You cannot separate, by the way, that's why Rabbi Bechaim once told me when I asked him that, why do we say, letaken olam b'malchut shakai? To fix the world in the kingdom of Hashem. Ba'achpati to fix the world. Say, lachzir kol am Yisrael b'tshuva shlema lefanecha. So it's a question that we ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So Bechaim said to me, he said, because through influencing the world around us, we'll be able also to influence the Jews. You cannot separate one from the other, which is exactly what Baal HaSulam says. You cannot separate this. You cannot say, I am for myself. As they say, the heck with the rest of the world. Everything is together. The Rambam says the same thing. The Rambam says, when you about to do your actions, one, or to measure your actions, one needs to know, as if the whole entire world is on a scale. Your action might tip it this way or that way. The whole entire world is dependent on your actions. You do an avera, you don't know. The whole world right now might be 50-50, completely balanced. your action is going to be the next action in the world, which tip it this way, or tip it that way. Now, what's going to be, boy? Yes or no? What are you going to do? Avera, mitzvah. What are you going to do? That's exactly what it says here. As I said to you, before, there's no difference between Kabbalah and Pshat. It's all one thing. As the Gra says, you understood something different than the other, you understood at least one thing wrong, if not both of them. Everything is therefore one entity. Therefore, a person needs to increase his pnimiyut, his spirituality. By doing so, he's increasing that spiritual HaKadosh Baruch Hu in him. On the chitzoniyut, the external, also, person needs to take care of. As much as you'll take care of the outside, you need to take care of the inside. One will influence the other. But if a person will increase the gashmiut in him, his spirituality will go down. It's a correlation. If a person will increase his spirituality, his physical world will go down. That's the way it works. For example, when you increase your chelek behemi, your behemic part in you, you're destroying your spiritual. And that, in return, would affect all the levels of existence in the world. So when you're destroying yourself, you're pulling the rest of the world with you. Your environment around you, the people around you, it becomes a ripple effect all over the world. For example, a person is not allowed to lie to his friend. Right? Even on minor things. A person needs to be able to say the truth. Why? Because you're not going to be able to lie, as I said to you many times, you're not going to be able to lie on one aspect. I'm going to only lie about external things, but when it comes to internal things, I would be a truthful man. You're going to end up lying yourself about God at the end as well. What will happen is, you're going to be kofer be'Hashem. You're going to lie to yourself. You have to be a truthful person. Tocho kebo, inside, at the outside. And the same thing in the world. When the whole world goes into a more spiritual phase, it affects from one side of the world to the other side of the world. But one needs to know that all the external issues are levels or a cover for the inside, on the heart. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says that the stories of the Torah are levushei Torah. They are the clothing of the Torah. That is, the external. Because Sefer HaTorah, HaChumash, or Tanakh, is not a legend story. It's not a, how we call it, mythology, Le'avdil Chas V'Shalom. But it's rather a book, a guidebook, how to worship Hashem. And it's the book of divine revelation. Therefore, the Zohar says, the Torah has four different levels. Sipurei HaTorah, the story of the Torah, are the levush, the clothing outside. Mitzvot HaTorah, the mitzvot in the Torah, are the body. Nishmat HaTorah, the soul of the Torah, is the Torah. And neshama, le neshama, it's something that is going to be revealed in the future. Latid lavod. That's something that we're going to get, Be'ezrat Hashem, when Mashiach comes. And there is a person, and people do it all the time. There are a person that would see a person who is another human being that is dressed up like a rabbi, right? And some crooks take advantage of that. Or like a big admor, and so on and so forth. Therefore, they look at him, they think that what? This person is a tzaddik, tzaddik gadol. Comes the Zohar and says, no, no, no. These people are fools. Tipshim. Why? Because you cannot measure a person by his clothing. Why? Because Halevush is not a person. Those people who are fools think that the Levush, the external, is the man. And the goof is the neshama. So therefore they are wrong in two different levels. Because they put, first of all, emphasis on external things as if they were internally. And therefore what will be is that these people live their lives in a lie. According to that, or to the opposite of that, the Maharhu, Rabbeinu Chaim Vital, writes that the goof of the Adam, the body of the person, is the shell, and the person is the neshama, is the soul. Therefore, if this determination that the neshama is you, what happens to you, or who really you are, or are you, when you destroy your neshama and you filth it? What does it tell about you as a person when your neshama is corrupted? You might look beautiful outside, like a model, but your inside is rotten. That who you really are. We should know what we say, the Shamayim, Shamayim LaHashem, Ve'aretz Atav LeAdam, that the Mekubalim said, we explained it before, even clothing that a person does, remember we were talking about taking a fruit from a level of Tzomeach, making a bracha, eating it, processing it, separating the good from the bad. Now we took this, for example, apple, and we elevated it so much that it became a part of me. It was elevated from a tzomeach, from a living plant, to a human being. It became a part of me. Even clothing that I wear, when I'm using my clothing, when I'm walking Lidvar Mitzvah, and anything else that I now elevated from one level to the other, according to the Mekubalim, kol hama'ale davar, by a bracha, by a mitzvah that I do, ke'ilu bera'o, as if I created it. Because right now, arguments say it was a barashka, it was a lamb. Right now, it became a person. In a way, I made that into a person. It's like I created it. Therefore, Hashamayim Shamayim LaHashem, Ve'aretz Natan Livnei Adam, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us this land to create better things. He gave us the instruments to make better things with it, to do mitzvot, to get closer to Him, to seek Him. That's why it bothers me so much when people use their intellect to say, this mitzvah does not make sense to me. I don't have to do it. That is such a hurtful statement that a person can make. Not to me, not even to God, for you. I feel bad for you. I feel bad for you because of what is that you're missing in life now. You don't have the most important ingredient in your life. You don't have God in your life. Mitzvot, through doing the mitzvot, we became a team with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So the more connectors we have, the better. I'm finishing. The more connectors we have, the better team we become. Why don't you want to be partners with HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Why would anybody do that? And why, when you do it, you don't do it out of true cheshek and desire, if I would tell you right now, listen, you have 1 hour to make $1 million, go do, reap the sidewalks here, you would figure out a way to reap the sidewalks. With such enthusiasm, you'll do it. Here I'm telling you, you could become partners with the Kadosh Baruch Hu by doing the mitzvot. How can you tell me that the mitzvot are a burden on you? You should come and say, Kadosh Baruch Hu, why only 613? Why could he give me 600,013? So therefore, lack of appreciation is our problem. So Bezat Hashem, I ask you, I beg you, not only to do the mitzvot, but also to learn, to investigate, to see how good and kind HaKadosh Baruch Hu that He chose us. Elu HaMishpatim. These are the Mishpatim. Be'ezrat Hashem, we'll do this. V'taher libeinu b'toratecha. And you should pure our heart with your Torah. Ki HaTorah kula otiyotav shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.